I tested all of these products for heavy metals. Some of the enzyme supplements I've tested in the past, protein powders, green drinks, and even baby food, but I didn't stop there. I also tested some of the most common foods in the average American kitchen, like Doritos, Oreos, wheat bread, and Cheerios. But then I thought, why not take it one step further? So I tested products that never seemed to have warnings on them, like fresh produce and bottled water. And what I found completely flips the narrative. Hi, I'm Danny Curtin. Thank you for joining me today. You've no doubt seen headlines about certain foods being loaded with heavy metals, especially dietary supplements. But I wanted to find out what we're really being exposed to. That's when I discovered the fact that when you compare what's found in natural, real, unprocessed food to what's found in manufactured supplements and packaged goods, the story suddenly gets a lot more complicated. So, if you've ever been confused or scared by headlines, lawsuits, or warning labels, stick around and I'll show you how to sort fact from fear. Now, I've got to make a few things clear because if you don't understand what heavy metals are, where they come from, how they get into our food, and how they're measured, it can be very easy to misinterpret real test results. For instance, I tested these two products for arsenic: Ben's Original Ready Rice Whole Grain Brown and good old Cheerios, 100% whole grain oats, and it's gluten-free. The amount of arsenic in Ben's Ready Rice tested to be 22 ppb, or parts per billion. And in the Cheerios, it was 29 parts per billion. Which one do you think is worse? For some of you, it may be obvious, but I want you to think about my question while you watch the rest of this video. All right. So, what are heavy metals and are they really heavy? Well, heavy metals are natural elements that can be found on the periodic table. But what makes them heavy is that they are extremely dense compared to most elements. Dense elements simply contain heavier atoms for the same amount of space. For example, you're probably familiar with the heavy metal lead. Lead's atomic weight is 207. Magnesium, on the other hand, a non-heavy metal with nutritional value, only has an atomic weight of 24. Extremely dense heavy metals are much harder for your body to break down and eliminate, and when you consume them faster than your body can eliminate them, they build up and stay in your body for long periods of time, where they can mimic essential minerals and sneak into places they don't belong, like nerves and bones. This allows them to disrupt cell, organ, and immune function, and the list, it goes on and on and on. Now, there is a long list of toxic heavy metals, but for our purposes, I'm going to be talking about the four most abundant: lead, arsenic, cadmium, and mercury, which are the specific metals I tested for as well. Now, in a perfect world, we'd avoid these toxins entirely, but they are in our soil. They enter the soil naturally when rocks break down, volcanoes erupt, and through other natural processes like forest fires. Human activities like farming add them to the soil as well. So, regardless of whether you think this is more of a natural phenomenon or a man-made problem, like I said, heavy metals are in the soil. That means anything you consume that comes from or is grown in the ground will contain some measurable level of heavy metal. And I say measurable in quotes because this is a misleading term that I've seen used in some reports and news headlines that are not only sensational, but can scare people about heavy metals as well. These headlines specifically state that certain foods contain measurable levels of heavy metal. They don't tell you how much heavy metal, they just say measurable. What they fail to mention is that heavy metals are in almost everything, and virtually any amount of heavy metal is measurable. Even watchdog groups that appear to have a concern for human health promote out-of-context information so that companies are forced to buy their clean label certifications, or consumers are scared into purchasing products that benefit these groups. It really comes down to this: if you're not being told how much heavy metal you're actually consuming in a typical serving of a product, there's no way to know if you're increasing your overall risk. Which is why being overly concerned about every trace of heavy metal in your food is the wrong approach. Don't get me wrong, there's truly no safe level of heavy metal exposure. but your body can detox and excrete a fair amount of these elements on its own. And you can support that detox even further if your diet and supplement regimen contain the proper chelating and binding ingredients, which I'll explain in more detail a little later. So the real danger here is when your intake exceeds what your body can handle. The best way to approach this issue is to ask, how much heavy metal is in my food? How much am I consuming, and how often? Figuring out these answers will allow you to make the most informed decisions that will have the biggest impact on your health. That's why the numbers matter. Reading that something contains 20 parts per billion of lead might sound alarming, especially if you eat it regularly. But what does 20 parts per billion actually mean? Well, it's simpler than it sounds. Parts per is just another way of expressing a percentage. It's not a fixed amount. It depends on how much of the item you're consuming. Since the percentages are so tiny, we use parts per billion instead. Otherwise, the numbers would be too small to comprehend. Let me show you with an example. Take a look at this apple pie. If I told you that 20% of this pie was made of apples and that the remaining 80% was everything else, I could technically say that this pie is 20 parts per 100 apples. Literally, out of 100 total parts, 20 parts are going to be apple. And to calculate, it's simple math. 20 divided by 100 equals 0.2, which is 20%. But let's expand on this example a little further. Imagine you taste this pie and you think, this isn't very sweet. It doesn't even taste like there's any apple in it. So like any normal person, you send the pie to a pie testing lab for further analysis. You want to know exactly how much apple, if any, is in this pie. The lab sends back the results and says the pie contains a measurable amount of apple, specifically 20 parts per billion, just like our earlier example of 20 parts per 100, where 20 out of 100 pieces were apple. Now we're breaking the pie into a billion pieces. These pieces are so tiny, you can't see them. But if we zoom in, 20 of those 1 billion pieces are apple. That means the pie is technically made up of 20 billionths of apple. Back to the math. 20 parts per billion equals 20 divided by 1 billion, which equals, get ready, 0.000002% apple. And now I think it's obvious why we use parts per billion when you see how small that percentage really is. It's basically meaningless, and you still have the same problem of not knowing how much you're actually consuming. But there's good news. There's a much faster and easier way to figure out what these numbers mean, and you don't have to be a math whiz. Parts per anything is simply a percentage. And because of that, we can apply that same parts per or percentage to any amount of material. Here's what I mean. Instead of thinking about a parts per billion measurement as some abstract microscopic fraction or percentage, let's apply the parts per billion number to a kilogram of material. I'm using a kilogram because the metric system fits together so neatly. When you see a parts per billion measurement, just imagine you have a kilogram of whatever the substance is. We break that kilogram into a billion pieces, which works perfectly because there are exactly 1 billion micrograms in 1 kilogram. Each tiny piece is a microgram, and that's a unit you can visualize. So with 1 kilogram and 1 billion micrograms in mind, I can tell you right off the top of my head, if a pie contains 20 parts per billion of apple, that means a kilogram of that pie contains exactly 20 micrograms of apple. The parts per billion number always represents that many micrograms if you're dealing with a kilogram of material. But we've got to go in the other direction, because I'm not eating the whole kilogram, 2.2 pounds of pie. I'm having a normal slice. This slice right here, it weighs 100 grams, and that's a typical serving. Referencing the metric system again, we know there are 1,000 grams in a kilogram. So a 100 gram slice is 10% of a kilogram. That means I'm eating 10% of the 20 micrograms in the full kilo. And 10% of 20 is 2. In this slice of pie, I'm consuming 2 micrograms of apple. Keep in mind that although I'm eating less, the slice itself still contains 20 parts per billion of apple. The percentage or saturation never changes. Same percentage, much smaller total. This is why simply applying parts per measurements to everything can make some things seem far worse than they actually are. And the opposite can happen too. So now that you understand parts per billion, let's briefly talk about parts per million. It works the same way as parts per billion, just on a larger scale. If parts per billion breaks something into a billion tiny pieces, parts per million only breaks it into a million pieces. That means one part per million is actually 1,000 times bigger than one part per billion. If 20 parts per billion means that there's 20 micrograms in a kilogram, 20 parts per million means that there are 20,000 micrograms in a kilogram, or 20 milligrams. Remember, parts per million is used for higher concentrations, and parts per billion is used for very small trace amounts. If you're not familiar with these measurements, at first, parts per billion might seem like they should be bigger than parts per million. But as you can see, it's actually the opposite. Let me show you how this plays out with the real test results I gave you earlier. Here are the arsenic test results for Ben's Ready Rice and Cheerios. I asked you which product you thought was worse. Ben's Ready Rice was 22 parts per billion and Cheerios was 29 parts per billion. If you said Cheerios was worse, that might be true, but only if you're comparing equal amounts of each product. Yes, Cheerios has a higher arsenic concentration at 29 parts per billion compared to 22 in the rice. But here's the problem. Are you going to eat the same amount of rice that you do Cheerios? Probably not. The rice itself is a lot more dense, so the serving size is probably going to be a lot different than the cereal. And that changes everything. All right, let's take a look at the package and see what the serving size is. So for the Ben's Ready Rice, let's see, it says right here, serving size, one pouch. So one serving of the Ben's Ready Rice is 250 grams. But when we look at the Cheerios, 1.5 cups or 39 grams. So even though the rice has a lower parts per billion, on average, you're eating a lot more of it. When you do the math, a serving of Ben's Ready Rice delivers 5.5 micrograms of arsenic. A serving of Cheerios, just over 1 microgram. So while the Cheerios look worse at first glance, the total amount of arsenic you're actually consuming is more than 5 times higher in the rice. This is exactly why parts per billion by itself can be misleading. Without factoring in how much of something you're eating, you don't get the full story. And without the full story, you can't know your true exposure. This is the kind of detail we'll be digging into throughout this series. If you found this information helpful, make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss what's coming next. A deep dive into the actual levels of lead, arsenic, cadmium, and mercury found in all of the products I had tested. Again, I'm Danny Curtin. Thanks for watching. I'll see you on the next one.